statistics say that women are overrepresented in the survivor category. But statistics are not people. People are people, not political footballs, not disposable news items, people. This year, I've seen how even the most seemingly common sense movements are lost in translation because others deliberately misrepresent them and then project division onto them that isn't even real. For instance, certain members of the commentariat have consistently labelled me as politically divisive, failing to mention that I spent most of last year having frank, productive meetings with politicians on all sides at both the state and federal level. So, after a year of being re-victimised, commodified, objectified, sensationalised, delegitimised, misquoted, gaslit, and thrown under the bus by the biased mainstream media, despite my inclusive messaging, on the 17th of August last year, not 5 months after being named Australian of the Year, I received a threatening phone call from a senior member of a government-funded organisation asking for my word that I wouldn't say anything damning about the Prime Minister on the evening of the next Australian of the Year awards. You're an influential person. He'll have a fear, they said. A fear? What kind of fear, I asked myself. A fear for our nation's most vulnerable? A fear for the future of our planet? And then I heard the words, you know, with an election coming soon. And it crystallised. A fear. A fear for himself and no one else. A fear that he might lose his position, or more to the point, his power. Sound familiar to anyone? Well, it does to me. So if those of us with a voice don't use it to fight for what is right, to fight for those without a voice, then what hope is there? What is the point of platforms like this? What is the point of life if not to connect, to communicate honestly and openly with one another in the pursuit of progress with whatever means possible? What is the point of awarding someone for their work only to stifle them while they do it when it gets too real?